What I will do, I might as well start at the beginning, and I'll give you basically a fertilizer primer. I tell you why it's important, how the importance differs around the world, because it's not the same pattern, and what we can do to make the efficiency of its use much better than it is right now. Why it's important is very simple. The biochemistry is very complex, but you don't have to know that. All you have to know is this. For us to grow, we have to produce all these proteins. Your eyelashes, your nails, your muscles, you name it. It's protein, except for the bones. So you need a protein. That protein is built up of amino acids. These amino acids contain, there is a bunch of them, but on the average they contain about 16% of nitrogen. So it's very simple. To get the eyelashes, muscles, nails, you need proteins. To make the proteins, you need amino acids. Amino acids cannot be synthesized without nitrogen. And the important point, we cannot synthesize them. We can do all sorts of things in our body, but one of the things which we cannot do is synthesize these amino acids. We have to consume them complete and ready-made, either by eating plants or eating animals which have eaten plants. Okay? And to get that nitrogen into those plants, they've got to take it from soil. So that's the sequence. Now, in traditional agriculture, there were very few ways how to get that nitrogen from that soil to the plants. It rained. Rain always contains a little bit of nitrogen from nitrate or ammonia in the air, but that's not enough at all. You could go and you could recycle the organic stuff, the crop residues, straw, roots, and of course you can recycle manures or human waste. And traditional agriculture, especially in Asia and in Western Europe, were doing it quite a bit. But that, you can clearly see, limits the amount of nitrogen you can put in, because you can recycle only as much as is available. If I grow in traditional agriculture 2 tons of grain per hectare, I will have about 3 tons of residues, straw. So the maximum I can put in is 3 tons of residue. And that residue, straw, is mostly carbon and hydrogen and oxygen, very little nitrogen. So maybe like 0.5%, less than 1% of nitrogen. So even if I recycle all that straw, which usually I couldn't, because I should take some of it to feed my animals or, you know, to make all sorts of little baskets or whatever in traditional agriculture. So it's always very limited. The same is manure. I can have only as much manure as I have animals. So it's always limited how much you can recycle. One way out of this is to mix the crops and start growing leguminose crops, because they are the only creatures in this world which are associated with bacteria in their root system, and these bacteria are able to take the nitrogen from the atmosphere and turn it into ammonia and feed those crops. So this is what we call the nitrogen-fixing crops, and every traditional agriculture used to do it. Chinese used to plant of soybeans and beans, Indians as of lentils and peas and beans, Western Europe, peas and beans again, and of course the North American Indians mixing corn together with beans. But again, it limits you, because as long as you have that leguminous crop, which is by nature low yielding and which people may not be so eager to eat, and which doesn't make good bread or no bread at all, you know, you notice there's no bean or pea bread, you are limiting the cultivation of rice or wheat, things which people want to eat. So no matter which you slice it, traditional agriculture has always limited amount of nitrogen, either through recycling or through growing leguminous crops. So this is why it was such a fundamental breakthrough when toward the end of the 19th century people said, you know, we've got to come up with a solution. We've got to bring an inorganic fertilizer. And we've done it with potassium, because you just go and dig up potash. And we've done it with phosphates. You just dig up phosphates and treat them with acid to make them more available. But we did have no way how to do it with nitrogen. Although we are living in this ocean of nitrogen, 80% of the atmosphere's nitrogen is in its form, which is not breakable. It's a very strong triple bond, which holds these two atoms of nitrogen together. So we had to come up with a method to break it down. And once it's broken down, that nitrogen combined with hydrogen and create ammonia. And finally, Fritz Haber succeeded, a great German chemist, in 1909, and he got the Nobel Prize for chemistry for this. And Karl Bosch, his colleague at the Bosch company in Germany, he led the project to turn this from scientific benchtop process into big industrial production. One of the most rapid industrial developments in the world. By 1913, this process was ready to go. So this is the great mark in the history of mankind, that since 1913 we have been able to take the nitrogen from the air, break it down, combine it with hydrogen, and make ammonia. And once you have ammonia, you can make other fertilizer out of it, you know, ammonium nitrate or urea. And now mostly it's urea, because it's a practical fertilizer, it's a solid, so it's easily spread on fields, easily available. So then it took quite a few decades, actually, for the production to ramp up. You know, First World War, the economic crisis. So really the fertilizers took only after the Second World War. And they, as Norman Borlaug, who got the Nobel Prize for Peace, for his basically fought the Green Revolution, as he said so aptly, it was the chemical fertilizers which provided the fuel for fueling the Green Revolution. Because you could have all these crops which perform very marvelously and which can, you know, yield much more, but because they yield much more, they will store more protein in their grain, they will need more nitrogen to make those amino acids to make the protein. So without large application of fertilizer, no green revolution, no increase in yields, and no possibility to have as many billions of people as we have now. This is why I keep concluding and telling people to their surprise that this is the most important invention of 20th century or of all times, because, you know, everything starts in people as far as we are concerned, and you could not have that many people without having that much food, without having that much fertilizer.